Welcome to the Radnor Hunt International 3-Day Event. Hello, this is Brian O'Connor along with Ralph Hill, and we'll take you into the exciting world of 3-Day Eventing. We are here just outside Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, for these national championships. In a 3-Day Event, there are three distinct phases. On day one, horses and riders perform the dressage test, where they're tested for control, balance, and precision. On the second day, the speed and endurance, they must go over a track of roads and tracks, steeplechase, and a demanding cross-country course of about 25 fences over banks, ditches, brush, in and out of the water, over a 3-mile track. That's where the courage and trust is really tested. And finally, on the third day, the stadium or show jumping, where the horses have to come back to see if they are still fit, if they're still agile enough to tackle a course of 10 to 12 fences in the show jumping arena. Well, don't go away. We'll be right back with the start of our exciting coverage of the Radnor Hunt International 3-Day Event. And welcome back to the Radnor Hunt Club. This is Brian O'Connor along with Ralph Hills. We show you some pictures of folks getting ready for these national championships. Well, Ralph, what does Radnor really mean to these folks?
Well, you know, you've spent all year to get ready for this one big event. This is one of the premier events for the greener, younger horses that hopefully are going to be our Olympic prospects next year. And there's just a great atmosphere. You know, you've worked hard, and now you're coming down to towards the end of the season. Everybody's got, you know, they're high about their new young horses. They want to show them off to each other. So this is where it's at. This is a wonderful event.
Well, let's get right to it. We had a chance to speak with one of the dressage judges about what they're looking for.
The dressage in the 3-day event is very important because we are proving that the horse is coming through in his training, is learning obedience and suppleness. And even though the jumping tomorrow is really the major test, the horse does have to have the dressage background. He is being asked the same things in the dressage on a lesser scale, with lengthening and shortening of stride and turning and making transitions. But the obedience and suppleness is probably the major thing we're looking for in the 3-day event dressage.
And here is our first rider of the coverage, Diana Fitzsimmons in Compact from Canada. As Brian said, the judges are looking for the best movements. They're given marks from 0 to 10. There are three judges. At the end of each ride, those points are all added up, and then the score is converted to a penalty mark. So the object is to finish with the lowest score at the end of the 3 days. Well, Ralph, tell us a little bit about some of the movements we're watching here in this particular dressage ride.
Well, some of the movements you're going to see, what they're trying to judge on is to see not only the suppleness and obedience of the horse, but to see the transitions from one gait to another, and also the accuracy of your movements. And, you know, we're dealing with some very fresh horses here that are fit enough to go 15 miles. So that's why it's important as a rider to understand that you're judged one movement at a time. Because if you do make a mistake or you have an explosion at one movement, you can regain some points on the next movement. So you're seeing here, looking at the two horses, the first horse, you can see a nice rhythm, nice cadence. It looked very smooth. This horse is a little tighter. You know, maybe he's showing the effects of the conditioning. Different horses and riders handle the pressure, you know, in this little arena by themselves in different ways. And this one we can see is a little more apprehensive than that last one, which was very fluid.
Here we have Abigail Lufkin in Lighter Than Air. This is a great combination. Horse and rider team have been really placing well. Abigail has ridden in the Young Rider Championships for many years. And this particular horse with another rider, with Mike Plum, one of our Olympic riders, was a winner of one of the preliminary divisions here last year.
Yeah, and I think that's a good indication. She has to feel very confident because, you know, horses like different events, believe it or not. And obviously this horse likes this track and this atmosphere. So this should be one to watch for.
That's right, Ralph. Abby's going to be one person really to look for at the end of each day. Now, here's another combination to watch for. Here's Karen Lindy in Park Hall. Karen has ridden at the World Championships and also at the Olympic Games for the United States.
Yes, and you know, this mileage that she has is very important because you can see here, this horse is a little tight, a little resistance. And this international experience that Karen has, you're going to see here, she's going to be able to create the illusion that everything is working out just the way she's planned. And she's sitting on a bit of a time bomb here.
So not only are you trying to make things work, but sometimes you have to cover it when it doesn't go right.
Well, exactly. I think Mark Phillips one year said a great thing in Ledger. He said, you know, sometimes in there half the art of it is how much you can hide from the dressage judges. Well, the dressage judges didn't like that comment, but he did win the dressage that day.
Here's the next of our Canadian riders. Here's Jason Pascoe in Cassidy County. Now, we have seen some really elegant-looking horses. Not that this horse isn't elegant, but he is different. He is a thoroughbred cross, possibly with some sort of draft horse. So what is really the ultimate horse, or is there really a type of horse that's better than others?
Well, I think that there's all different types, you know, and shapes like any other athlete. But the ideal situation I think you'll see in the Olympic Games and top levels are more your thoroughbred types for the speed and endurance, because that's where the heavy load is. And you'll see more of a thoroughbred type. However, you can see this horse right now. He's looking pretty elegant. He's got a lot of suspension. But he's got a very good temperament, and that could be a strong point. He might not have all five running gears like a thoroughbred, but if he's good in the mind, he might only need three gears.
Mark Weisbecker on Ambrass from Massachusetts, another one of our experienced riders. He's ridden here many times. He had some bad luck here last year with a fall on the cross country. He wasn't able to finish, but he's putting in a very elegant round here, very controlled, very precise, and he should be in the top standings.
Yes, that was very nice. And you can see this girl, we're talking about different types of horses and so forth. Here's a horse from Arizona that's done everything. I mean, he's probably even had a Western saddle on him, but we know that he's hunted coyote and everything. So, I mean, this horse should not be worried about anything that happens within this arena. As I said, the only thing he might have to worry about is getting used to grass, because he's used to the desert.
That's right. Yeah, Wendy comes all the way from Las Vegas, Nevada, for this competition, and Radnor is one of the premier fall events, as you said earlier, and people do come from all over the country to compete here. It's a big deal.
Oh yeah, it really is just a wonderful event time of the year, and the horses love to run this time of the year, so that's why I think we get so many different people from so many states and even from Canada.
Here's Darren Cha-Cha on Amethyst. This is one of the very few stallions we have here competing. He is a breeding stallion, Turkana Stallion, and here's Darren down the center line as he finishes off his dressage test. He has had an elegant round. This horse is really motoring here as he goes down that final line.
Well, and you could just see the stallions have a bigger crest on their neck, a bigger neck, a little more presence, and he's nailed one.
I think Darren's got to be pretty pleased with that round. He, in fact, was the last to go. And watch some of the crowd waiting for his scores to come up. Nice big smile at the end of the day. Well, let's take a look at the leaderboard now. And we find that Darren did, in fact, have a great go, but he's just behind Karen Lendy. So Darren's in second place, 44.2. Karen Lendy with Park Hall, the gray horse, taking the lead with 41.6. Mark Weisbecker, Ambrose in third. Abigail Lufkin in fourth. Joni Peters in Snap Decision moved to fifth. Sarah Irving and Full Circle are sixth. Well, we'll be right back with more coverage of the Radnor Hunt International 3-day event. Don't go away. Welcome back to the Radnor Hunt International 3-day event. We are here now with the heart of any 3-day event, the Speed and Endurance or Cross Country Day. Thousands of people have come out on this beautiful day to watch the horses and riders tackle this demanding course. Well, Ralph, give us a breakdown now of the Speed and Endurance Day.
Well, Brian, we have four phases. Phase A and C are roads and tracks held at a trot. Phase A is 2 miles long to get you warmed up for Phase B, the steeplechase. And as you see, this horse is running at a high rate of speed because this girl has to make time. If you don't, you are penalized. After you do the steeplechase at this high rate of speed, you instantly go right out onto Phase C, which is 4 miles, and the object of Phase C is to partially let your horse recover at the same time as testing out the endurance of your horse. And as you come off of Phase C, you go right to the vet box.
Now at this point, the horses are checked by the vets to see if they're fit and ready to continue. They're checked with pulse, respiration, temperature, and it'll give you a 10-minute breather before you go out. And the vets have an important decision at that point.
Correct. If they feel your horse is not sound or fit enough, then you do not get to go.
Well, let's go out on the cross country and take a look at some of the fences on that Phase D.
Well, what you're going to see here, now these horses have already traveled a lot of miles, and you're seeing these first two to three fences are just nice galloping straightforward fences that get the horses on their feet. And then you come all of a sudden to a first complex, a bank complex, where you have to jump up on it, take two or three strides, and then out into space over a big log to your first serious question, which is what we're seeing here, the brush and water.
This combination here is probably, this is one of two fences on the course that entails jumping in and out of water. This is much more difficult than the second one because the horses are jumping into water that they can't see.
Exactly, and it looks very dark there, and the horse doesn't know how deep it is, and they have to trust us that we're not going to ask them to go in something over their head.
Here's another combination where the riders can jump a bounce on the right where the horse hits the ground, takes right back off again for the second, or they can go the long way. Then they go up a long gallop to the pine rails at 9 to 10, which entails going across a road up there. You got to be real careful about your line there.
Correct, and they're very vertical, very straight up and down, which when your horse is getting tired, sometimes they're not as quick using their front legs, and you have to be aware of that. But then you see after that, they give you some nice straightforward galloping fences, a big fence there and a ditch, and here's a fence in the woods, to these double ditches, which is your next probably tough complex.
This is a fence that's been really changed this year. They have a ditch and brush, two to three strides, and another ditch and brush. And then on to another big ox or big spread fence. And here's the second water. You can see that the horses can really look into the water here. They can see what the fence is about, and they have to make a right-hand turn. That's going to be difficult.
Right, the right-hand turn is the most difficult thing there, but you said, as you said, is very fair there because they can see what they're getting into. And then some nice fences to get home.
And we're on the course now with Bruce Davidson and Eagle Lion. He has a good ride through the banks there at 4A and B.
Yeah, and it's very important to get a good ride there. You've got to be very positive because this water complex we know is going to ride tough. This is the bogey fence. Whoop, a little sticky there, a little bit of a rough ride, but hey, that's cross country.
Bruce, of course, one of our veterans out here. He's ridden on four Olympic teams. He's also currently holding the bronze medal from the World Championship. He showed that style nicely through the bounce there at 7. Here's Diana Fitzsimmons and Compact. They were 10th after the dressage. Little sticky there on and off the bank.
Yeah, I think we're seeing a little bit of a green rider and horse combination here, or one or the other. You could see this horse wanted to be a little bit airy over his jump, but there he put plenty of room coming out of the water.
She kept really balanced there. It's also a drop into that water, so the riders really have to make sure that they keep the center of balance through that combination to help the horses.
Exactly. You could see a bit of a bobble there, you know. She got jumped out of the tack a little bit there. That's greenness.
Here's Bruce and Eagle Line on the back of the course through the double ditches and brushes, and a good ride there. So he has about four more to go now on the course. He comes up to the Tidworth.
Well, and you can see the rough edges are starting to get worked out now, and that's the way it is when you're riding a greener horse you're bringing along. They're getting more and more confident the better you ride him. You can see, look at this horse. He's starting to focus. Bruce gave him a good positive ride there. And look how this horse stays focused coming out, which is what he wasn't at the first water complex. So this horse is getting educated.
Here's Lindsay Mann and Ringwood Conrad, also from Canada. They come to the water.
Oh, you can see a little
real
sticky
bad
there.
Really hung a leg back.
Oh,
there,
man, sometimes that's where the Vaseline, when we put her on their legs, the cream helps a lot. But you can see this rider's sitting a little bit heavy in the tack, and that stick is already flipped up. You know, this horse must not be firing right now.
They're okay through the bouncers. Dinah Fitzsimmons on the back. A huge, this horse really picking his legs up like a little kangaroo.
Oh, man, that's what we call the In God We Trust seat, as you saw the way she landed there. What happens, obviously, this horse is green. He hasn't learned how to get into his brush yet. What a wonderful leap, though.
Really very clever with his feet. Let's see how he comes down to the second water.
Wonderful expression. Look at his ears. Oh, there she got.
A little bobble on the. Oh,
what an athletic move there.
Almost coming down. Really put in a. He put in a short stride on the takeoff. Here's Mara Laframboise and the Shark into the water. Big ride, strong ride through there.
Okay, and you can see Mara's international experience there, how she leaned back. She knew the horse was going to stall there. She got right behind him, which was really good. Little anxious moment there in front of that bounce. She tipped forward with her shoulders.
Here's Lindsay Mann now, Ringwood Conrad. Oh, they picked up a refusal at the ditch.
Oh, that could be a close call. It almost looked like he wanted to represent him at that longer option.
Now, the scoring on the cross country is 20 penalties for a refusal, 40 for a second, 60 for a fall on the course. He's picked up 20 there. Now he's going to go the long route. He's going to take a little more time there. He knows he already has the 20 faults, so he wants to get through the combination with no more faults added.
Right. Obviously, the horse didn't want to play over those ditch and brush, so he opted there to take the longer way. That's why they build these courses, you know, with safety valves like that.
And here's Mara over the ditches and brushes there. A good ride.
Very efficient, you could see. Very direct. Just jumped the effort that he needed. Look at this. His ears are pricked. She's going the fast way. Perfect. Right on.
Let's go to the finish and talk to Lindsay Mann.
Yeah, the horse went really well. He came up to the double ditches at the far end. I'd heard there was problems with it, so we gave him a few whacks to wake him up. And he came into it, and he had his distance right. And he took a funny stride, and then he slid into it. So I took the option off to the right-hand side. But he was just great.
On the front of the course, here we have Joe Struby and H. Nicholas. Big jump on the bank and back over the log.
And you can see, it was a little sticky there. You could see her get after him. This is going to be interesting to see how this one goes.
And onto the... Oh, she's really got hung up there at the water.
Oh, man, there's the prime example of too much speed, not enough impulsion.
But she doesn't pick up any faults there. Back at the finish, here's Moira.
Actually, yeah, he's green. He had a year of plan, basically, with different rides. And I've only done about a handful with him. So I was still at this level. It's quite green.
But he did really well.
Yeah, he was great. Covered my ass. He's done.
Ralph and I will be right back with more exciting coverage of the Radnor Hunt International 3-day event right after these messages. And welcome back to Radnor. This is Brian O'Connor along with Ralph Hill. And here we have Joe Struby and H. Nicholas on the back of the cross country through those double ditches and brushes.
And you can see this horse just isn't looking quite as interested. He's not making a commitment. She's having to work, as you can see by her going to the stick there, to add a little encouragement. He's still staying focused, but he's just not firing.
Here's Abigail Lufkin and Lighter Than Air. She's on the front of the course, up to the bank complex, and a good ride there. Surely had to slip those reins to keep balanced.
Yeah, you can see this horse is jumping like a little rubber ball. His ears are focused. He's popping.
Good ride there.
Very slick. There's the way it's done.
That's textbook right through there. Ab's having a great round. Here she comes to the sherry bottle, the bounce. And she is clear there at seventh.
Yes, I had a nice ride. I didn't have a very good throat go through the water jump.
Which one?
First one. Brush. Yeah, we got hung up on it on the first part coming in. After that, yeah, we went clear. Mm-hmm. Yeah, after that, pretty much we jumped everything else quite nicely.
On the front of the course here, we have Karen Carco and Kelton to the water complex. And a big jump in there. He really dropped his back legs there, Ralph.
Oh, he really did. And you notice she didn't lean back with her body, which was interesting. She took a heck of a gamble there for jumping in that fast and flat.
You think the riders approach this fence any differently now that the word's gotten back, you know, after the first 10, 15 horses have gone through?
Well, yeah, I think we're seeing the riders are starting to think it's a problem, so they're riding a little bit over-aggressive now, and again, forgetting about that balance and impulsion.
Abigail, great through the brushes there. She's really tearing it up on the back of the course here.
You can see this horse is still jumping off the ground. He's still got suspension. He's using his legs good. This horse is obviously fit for this task.
She comes down to the second water. Little bobble there. She really had to drive him forward to keep him going.
Yeah, you know, but that's why he's like a little rubber ball. You can see even from that deep distance, he's able to shorten real quick and fire right over.
Here's Kelly Temple and Deja Vu on the front of the course. Here's to the first water. And a jump in there, but once again, there's another horse dropping hind leg.
Yeah, I think part of this water complex is it's a focusing exercise, and the horses don't see where they're going, and then all of a sudden they get up in the air, see the water, and they're leaving their hind end. And you can see through that bounce, it definitely raises consciousness on his hind end.
Here's Kelly through the road crossing, and we go back to the finish for Abigail.
He was great. He really was good, yep.
Was he a pistol? Is this horse a little bit of a pistol? Sometimes he gives that impression.
Yeah, a little bit, not so much tough, just a little bit naughty, you know, he can be. But it was great, and this is, you know, he's just done the two intermediates, and this is by far the biggest thing he's ever seen. And it was great.
Got to be a great feeling of accomplishment to see those double zeros, no faults added after cross country.
Oh, yeah, she's got to be very excited because, you know, she's sitting fourth in dressage. She's just put the pressure on the other three riders that are ahead of her.
Here's Karen Carco now, a little bit tentative there through the brushes. Here she is at the water.
Oh, yeah, and you can see she paid a little price for that. He was a little apprehensive, and he just didn't fire out of that turn. Now she's trying to get him gathered up and minimize the damage now.
You think this horse is thinking about that first water at all as he comes to the second one?
You know, he did take a real...
Oh, really getting hung up on that log.
He did take a real sting there front and back at that first water, and that could very easily, you know, especially with these greener horses, influence it.
And here's Kelly through the brush in and out here. on the back of the course, and she's clear.
You can see, you know, that big ditch coming out really showed it was a big effort, but she rode very positive for the two strides, so she helped him out a little bit. She's starting to carry him a little.
And around to the water now.
Yep, now you'll see she'll get after him a little bit. She's sitting in a good tight position. Little stall there, but nice. I mean, he was nice and tight.
And a big jump out.
Yeah, it stopped, but it went really well other than that.
That was in the second water. So, and something went wrong in the first water?
No, he was just very, very bold, and I think it surprised him because there was water in there.
Do you think that affected him in the second water?
It may have. There was a lot of people. I kind of lost all my momentum in the turn. And
so it was on the way out?
No,
in.
You come off the road and turn.
So is he a young horse with somewhat inexperienced?
Yeah, second CCI, so.
So those crowds can do that sometimes, don't they? Yeah. Especially when you're heading straight for them.
They do. But he was good. He jumped really well other than that.
There's a picture of Deja Vu, so Kelly must have just come off the course there. Let's have a word with her.
He was a little green at the water. He jumped very boldly into the brush and then landed in the water and just almost stopped dead. Because he just hadn't expected, I think, it to be water. He couldn't see it. And I really hung in the back seat, so luckily I didn't get shot off the front. I could easily have, and then I just kicked him on, and he was great. He really answered some things today. I thought he was good, and he just kept right on going. So,
so maybe we have another McAvity in the making.
Yeah, he's just seven, and this is really his first year.
We'll be right back with more cross-country action, including the riders that are in the lead. They are still yet to come on the course. And welcome back to the Radnor Hunt International 3-Day Event and the cross-country action. Well, Ralph, here's Jason Pascoe, Cassidy County.
Oh, man, did you see that clever move that horse did with his hind end? This is what we're talking about, these half-breds. You saw how clever he was there. That's an instinct of survival right there.
One of the very few horses we've seen not drop his hind end into the water.
Exactly. This horse looks like he could be a real solid citizen and a real fun ride out there. He's very cat-like for a big horse.
And there he is over the road crossing. Now here's Mark Weisbecker in Ambrass.
Man, I tell you, that horse had to slow up. If that horse would have gone as fast as Mark was running down there, we might have seen pieces everywhere.
Well, Mark's had trouble at water jumps with this horse in the past, so he rides very aggressively through 5A and B.
Well, and as you well know, Brian, sometimes you've seen me wing my elbows going down to a water complex like that. Obviously, this horse has at one point had some trouble with water, and he's taken the worry out of 20 penalties.
Now, Mark has an extra little bonus here. He knows that Karen Lendy has withdrawn in the vet box, so he goes out on the course now in second place with the leader having dropped out.
Well, plus, and don't forget, we have Abigail that went clean and fast earlier that's sitting behind and breathing against Mark, so that could be one of the reasons he's letting it fly here.
There's Jason through the water. Great ride there.
Oh, you can see that horse is just really a cat.
Now here's Lisa Anderson in Corbell to the first water at 5.
Now this is a little bit of a... Oh!
Oh, she's going to...
Wonderful save.
Oh, she stayed in there, saved those 60 penalties.
Oh, man, I'll tell you, that's why us event riders are usually pretty good dancers, because we have to do all sorts of moves up there on those horses, you know? I mean, that's why you condition yourself.
It's actually, the rain looked like it flipped over the horse's head there. So she has to come back out. Now, she doesn't have to necessarily jump the first part. She has an option of jumping the first part again or just jumping the second, and that's what she's going to do. Real smart play here.
Well, exactly. I mean, we certainly wouldn't want to go try that one again after that kind of ride in. Now, there's a mare, obviously, that just wasn't as clever as the last horse we had. This is a well-bred mare, a lucky boy horse, so she's got the jump, but she just there with some green mistakes.
And here's Mark in Ambrose, the back of the course to the double brushes.
And you can see a big difference from the last horse we saw. He's really running. He's aware, very aware of where he's sitting right now.
Here he comes to the second water. Once again, a very aggressive ride. He doesn't want that horse to stop at all. He knows with a clear round he can move up and take second place by himself.
Exactly, and you saw him stay in the back seat a little bit there going in because he knew he was taking a gamble.
Here's Jackie Page to the banks. He's going to pick up a refusal. Oh, the horse has gone down. And it looks like Ralph looks like he's got his legs caught in the fence there.
Yeah, well, you can see he's just right now, he's just a little bit stunned there. You know, it's like the National Football League. We all take good hits from time to time, but that's why we get ourselves in condition and fit. This horse right now, he's taking his time. He's got a good mind. He's not fighting it. He's going to figure out how to get out of there without hurting himself. And you'll find usually nobody gets hurt.
And he's up and out there. You can see all the officials and the stewards right on the scene instantly to make sure everything is safe. If they have to take the fence apart to get a horse out, they will do that.
Well, exactly. And the thing of it is Jackie will now get on him, see if he feels all right. And if he does, she'll continue.
There's Lisa through the backwater.
Yeah, it looks like they've got it back together a little bit now.
And Jackie and Pinocchio back together. She's right back up. She has to go back over the same jump now.
And you see, he does it really wonderful. That's a good horse. That was just a freak mistake. It looked like he was looking down between the top two rails. Just didn't figure it out. And it was coming a little bit slow.
Here he comes to the water.
Look at this.
No trouble at all.
That shows you a well-conditioned athlete, good preparation.
That's a good round. Yeah. So, a nice change from other events we've had in the past.
He's been giving you a little difficulty at times.
Yes. He has a problem in that he's really, really careful. And he's such a talent and so good that if he feels like he's insecure in any way for whatever reason, he just doesn't want to go because he doesn't want to hurt himself. It's the kind of horse you feel really safe on when you're riding him because you know that he's going to do everything he can to stand up and get to the other side or stop. But he's been getting more and more confident as we've been going along, and this is, you know, a good way to finish up.
Because that first water is pretty tough, and that's where you have had your trouble in the past.
The good thing about the water is that it had brush in front of it, and he didn't know he was going into water until he left the ground.
Was he surprised?
No, not too bad. He just sort of took two strides, and out he went, and carried on.
Well, there's another clear round. Mark's now in second place. He's had a superb go on the cross country here as we watch Craig Thompson and Solitaire negotiate the banks at four.
Yeah, you can see he didn't trust him quite off of the bank there. He went to the stick a little bit there. It looks like he's really riding this horse. You can see he's getting in the back seat. Yep.
Out over 5B. Craig using the stick there just as a little extra encouragement, I guess. Here he comes to the bounce.
Oh, you can
really
see.
Sitting back there.
That's what we call the backseat bandit, you know. Going over the bank was the hay on the taxi, but that's the backseat bandit there.
Here he is through the road crossing.
Well done there.
Let's go back and talk to Jackie.
He jumped on top halfway over and almost didn't have enough oomph. And he slipped under and he was stuck under it for 5 minutes.
Are you talking about the first element?
First element, yeah. I had his feet stuck under it. So then they pulled him out and I trotted him because I thought, shoot, I'm not going to go. And I trotted him up and he was sound. And he was clean the rest of the way through and fast, like strong and
so,
so much
really
horse.
Rallied.
Oh, he was amazing. I mean, he was a poor thing. He got stuck right in his fence, and he got up and says, okay, let's go again. Oh, he was so
good. Had him for long.
It's always great to see both horses and riders come out of a fall like that, which looks spectacular, but both of them are safe.
Well, yeah, that's true.
Oh, Marcia Carabel now through the water, hanging a back leg very badly over the first brush there. She is really going quite a lick here.
Yeah, she's taking some unnecessary risks.
Little!
Right
oh, my goodness. That's a little too fast for the bounce there.
Yep. It'll take her one more level up to realize she can't get away with that at a bounce. This horse is really jumping brave. It's not phasing him one bit.
Craig Thompson and Solitaire to the double brushes. Craig's still at that stick. I wonder if the horse is tired or whether he's just doing that on the course today.
Yeah, I think it's building both of their confidence a little bit, I think, is what it looks like.
It comes to the water. Horse jumps very neatly in there.
And look at that, on the loose rein going down there. That just shows you there's no better master of their legs than the horse.
Now here's the leader, Darren Chacha and Amethyst. Now, he was second after the dressage, but with Karen Lending having to drop out. We'll watch him go through the water there. With Karen Lending dropping out, Darren knows with a clear round, he can take the lead to the show jumping.
Well, that's correct. And you're going to see we're talking about different types of horse, thoroughbreds versus warmbloods. If you look at this horse, he looks like he's going nowhere, you know. And it's probably because he's got a very big, lumbersome stride versus some of the thoroughbreds we saw that were running fast. He lost a pedal there.
I hit a little cab here and there. But I think I'm real happy with it. I wouldn't say rough. I'd say effective. I've had a little bit of trouble these last couple of events with my concentration and staying on top of the horse.
What are you thinking about, women or something?
Most likely, yeah.
Well, here we have Marcia Carabell, Alden's image, on the back of the course. She's still going very fast here, Ralph.
Oh, I tell you, I love this girl's spirit, and this horse looks like he's still got tons of gas left.
And she comes down to the water.
Look at this horse. You can see he's focused way early. Came around the turn. That's a fresh horse. He can come out of a turn, prick his ears like that. Look at that. Right through the water. Boom. Gone.
Darren on Amethyst through the road crossing, the rails.
Yeah, this combination's not really been causing any problem all day, but this is the one he has left to really ride strong, and this water complex coming up.
We're still hitting good stride. Looks as though his time is all right so far.
Yeah, and it's very deceptive. The last horse we saw, you could see, flew up that hill. This horse has that big, big, lopey stride. This will be interesting to see here. There, oh, he's focused. We're all right.
And a big jump out.
It was super. She's been really good. I noticed you tried a few finish flags. Were you real ahead of time or something?
Yeah, I was a little bit too fast, and I thought I had a good pace going. At one point, I thought my watch stopped, so I kept up a little bit too fast of a pace.
And you did pretty well in dressage, so I guess you're...
Yeah, he had a good dressage score. The course was excellent.
Yeah, you liked how it rode?
Yeah, very galloping. Excellent fences. Could have been a little more challenging technically, I think.
And there's Darren after a clear round on the cross country. Let's get a few words from him.
So you haven't had this horse for very long, have you?
No, this is, I ran him once early spring and just twice recently, and this is my first 3 day with him. So, it was great to have him go around well today.
Can you do better knowing you're winning, or?
I don't know, I tried not to think about it. I mean, you know, it's not over yet.
And how true that is, Darren. Darren's in the lead by just 1.5 points. Mark Weisbecker in second, Abigail Lufkin third, Joe Struby fourth, Kelly Temple moves up from 15th, and Marcia Carabell moves up from 16th, now in 6th place. We'll be right back with a final day of competition here at the Radnor Hunt International 3-day event. We'll be back with the show jumping right after these messages. And welcome back to the Radnor Hunt International 3-day event, our final day of competition, the show jumping. Here we see scenes of some of the patrons and some of the folks behind the scenes at the trade fair. There's always great food, lovely arts and crafts, and there's a little bit of everything here for kids, for grown-ups, and for animals. We have the dog agility demonstration. Here's a few words about their operation.
Dog agility is a sporting event for dogs that was created in England in 1977. A spectator event for the Crufts Dog Show to fill in between classes. It caught on very quickly in England as a true sporting event and has spread around the world, coming to the United States first time in 1986. We have formed the United States Dog Agility Association, which now has 70 clubs around the country that compete and hold tournament events and so forth. We've got a demonstration team here at Radnor this year for the third year in a row to display the sport and to help people participate in the obstacle course. This obstacle course is patterned after the equestrian show jumping. We've added some obstacles from the military canine corps training. Dog agility is one of the few sports in the United States where the breeding of a dog has no meaning in competition. We permit mixed-bred dogs as well as the purebreds to participate, and all we ask is that they have some athletic ability to manage the obstacles safely.
Well, Ralph, let's hope that the horses have as many clear rounds as the dogs did there.
Well, I have to question that, because Steve Stevens is a master at knowing how to build a big course and how to use the flat cup.
Kelly. Here we are with Kelly McMullen and Deja Vu. As we said earlier, they moved up from 15th to 5th after the cross country.
You know, and the rails will come down pretty easy with these flat cups, and Steve Stevens is really slick at how to design the course with this undulating ground. I mean, you can see, not only did they go 11 miles yesterday, but now they're going up and down in this field, and that's what Radnor's notorious for, is trying to balance a horse that's a little bit tired, you know, a little bit stale the final day, and you're going uphill, downhill, and there's flat cups. These fences will come down, and you're penalized for that.
And with the standings being so close, with less than 5 points separating the top four or five horses, a dropped rail, which is penalized by 5 penalties, is going to be very costly, and it's going to knock these people right out of the standings.
Well, exactly, and the thing of it is they're running in reverse order of go. So these riders like Kelly and And Joe and they can put a lot of pressure on the top three riders, and that's, you know, that's going to add up towards the end of the day.
So far, Kelly's having a clear go.
Yeah, the horse has been jumping. He's putting a lot of room in front of his jump. She's got to be, you know, she knows right now this horse is jumping sharp enough to jump clean. So she just has to hold her concentration for a couple more jumps. She's gone through what I consider the more difficult parts of the course. Now she's just got to get him home over one more jump.
And there she is over the last, no faults added, so a clear round. That really does put the pressure on the top riders.
Well, and that can work one of two ways. You know, you saw how it's supposed to be done. So the rider sitting first, second, and third should be able to, you know, sit there and see that that's the rhythm and the balance you need.
On the course now, Joe Strube and H. Nicholas.
You can see this horse is jumping a little slower, a little more lethargic than the last one. She's going at. She's in a little trouble.
Got to kick on. Now there's five faults added.
Well, see, that's a related...
Oh, she dropped a second rail there. That's 10, so that's really going to drop her in the standings.
Exactly. See, that's a related distance in there, and she added a stride. Rather than leaving it out, she's in real trouble.
Almost went down there.
She's lost concentration a little bit. She let that rail bother her, and, of course, both of them got a little rattled there. Now, her job as a rider is to minimize the damage, whether she's lost it or not. Let's give this horse a good final round. So you've got to start pushing them up into the bridle a little bit more and, you know, inspire them. Oh, my God, you shouldn't be trotting.
And do you think that this is horse is just tired or maybe just not focused? Or?
Yeah, I think that, you know, we noticed yesterday, you know, in the cross country, she was going to the stick three quarters of the way around, and this horse might be feeling a little bit of the effects of that.
I know that's got to be disappointing. There's another one. That's four down so far.
Well, yeah, and you know, you watch his expression is fine on his face, but he knows now that these fences are coming down and they don't really sting, you know, because of these flat cups and symmetric rails, and now he's just sort of lost interest. And you can see now he didn't even try to miss that jump. You know, this is go back home, and I'd hit tons of jumper shows in the winter.
Here she comes down to the last. And unfortunately, with the six dropped rails, that's going to add 30 points to her score. And she's going to go way down now, finishing up with 86.2.
Yeah, it's a shame to have worked that hard, but she's got to be excited about yesterday she jumped in.
Well, we'll be back with the final three rides of the Radnor Hunt International three-day event right after this. And we're back with the final three rounds of the Radnor Hunt International three-day event. Here's Abigail Lufkin and Lighter Than Air, currently in third place with 50.2. And Ralph, I don't need to mention the pressure here because there's only less than 10 points between first and third.
Oh, yeah, on the way, the stadium's been riding all day. I mean, the pressure is definitely an understatement. And you can tell she's going to have to make a little move to get out this distance. But, see, now the jitters will be over from a rider standpoint of view. This little horse, he's more compressed than the last horse we saw. He's firing off the ground with a little bit of a ping. You see, he just got over that one. So now as a rider, she knows that, you know, her horse is there. He's jumping well. She's just got to concentrate on not making any big, quick move.
Horse got a lot of energy after the tough cross country yesterday.
And you can see there she called on the scope a little bit. She opted to add the stride going down that line vertical to an oxer and made him have to really work out of the oxer, and he responded right away. So right now she's got to be feeling pretty confident.
And a big jump there over the spread fence.
You know, and it's interesting contrast. This horse is only 15-3. You know, he's a little English thoroughbred cross, and you can see this horse, you know, is noted to be a good show jumper, and you can see why. He's got a very good technique with this front end, and you can see that he jumps off the ground with authority.
Well, this is a little guy, Ralph, that goes to prove that the little horses, once again, come shining through in our sport.
Yeah, there's been many good horses, little horses in our sport. And you can see this combination has really been holding their concentration. This is a very long course for what they did yesterday.
And a clear round at the last. There is a All great right. round for her. She adds no faults there. She has really put the pressure on Mark and also on Darren.
Well, she can sit back and really relax now. A lot of pressure just came off that girl's shoulders, but it's all put on these next two riders.
Mark Weisbecker and Ambrose now in second place with 45.6.
And the horse was a little bit strong there. You could see he almost what we call run past his distance. And, you know, with these fences, you have to jump them careful because of these flat cups.
Now, for those folks who may be watching, you've talked about that a couple of times. Now, you're talking about the actual cups that are holding the rails, right?
Correct. There's many different sizes of cups that are holding these rails up. And out on this course, throughout it, there's certain sections that have very flat, shallow cups.
Just the slightest rub can knock these rails right out and cost the horses and riders five faults.
Correct. And, I mean, as we well know right now, that could be costly.
We've seen a lot of rails come down today.
Well, and you can see this horse has been riding a little bit rougher than Abigail's horse. You know, you can see him right there. Mark had to do a quick check. And, you know, sometimes with these type of horses, they get more of a head of steam up as they go on. Their blood sort of gets pumped, and you can see he's a little hard coming out of that turn. Mark's doing a good job here.
He's going to have to keep him balanced, especially in the downhill combinations. He turns left. He comes downhill now. So he really has to keep that horse balanced and in check. He comes up to the in and out.
Whoop, this horse is trying to run out.
Oh, very wise to keep him up, but he's dropped the rail there.
Well, he did a wonderful piece of riding to save that. The mistake that he made is when the horse got up in the air, Mark sat up a little quick, didn't let go of that left rein, and that caused the horse to drop his hind end. That's a tough break.
So over the last there, one dropped rail, five faults, 50.6. So he drops just below Abigail now by 0.2 of a point.
Well, I'll bet you out in Abigail's crew is dead silent right now to watch this last round.
Here's Darren Chacha now with Amethyst.
Now, for this boy's first 3-day on this horse, I'll bet you he can hear his heart pounding through his ears right about now.
Now, he's got roughly 9 points in hand, so he can have one rail and still win it. And there is the one rail, but that's all he has now, right?
Yep, you sort of hate to use that rail up that early in the course. You know, that vertical has been coming down the American flag, but you hate to use it that early for the way the rest of the course has been riding.
So he has to really concentrate now. He goes to the high end of that fence.
Yeah, I mean, that's a bit of a gamble there. I don't think he was aware of the horse drifting right.
He's really going to have to stay balanced and really in control now.
And, you know,
to take this championship.
This horse has got a lot of jump. He's jumping fairly easy. It's just now that, you know, they can't make a mistake. And what you have to realize, you pulled the one rail, you've got to shut that out of your mind as a competitor and ride to get the rest of the fences clean. You can't be worried about where you're at now. Concentrate for the moment. They both look very peaceful here right now. You took that time to make a nice big loop to get themselves back together.
Yeah, it's smart riding there.
Yeah.
Oh, there, unfortunately, that came down. That's a second rail, and that's going to drop him out, Ralph. That's going to drop him all the way to third place now, so you can see how close that was.
Yeah, that was really a shame. He did a very smart move in making that big round turn to give himself time. But again, it's towards the end. He pushed this horse to make the time. It's going uphill, which is always tough, an uphill oxer, and it's got flat cups with a plank in front, and it just, that's a shame.
Oh, so 10 faults added there. That's very unfortunate, and Darren drops down to third.
What are you going to do next?
Go on vacation.
Congratulations.
And congratulations all the way around for Abigail Lufkin and Lighter Than Air, the 1991 Radnor Hunt 3-day event winners. Mark Weisbecker, Ambrose in second. Darren Chacha drops to third. Kelly McMullen takes fourth. Marcia Carabel and Alden's Image fifth. Larzy DuPont and Intake sixth. Alexandra Putnam Vodabog seventh. Bruce Davidson and Eagle Lion taking eighth. Well, Ralph, you've been up here in the Victory Garden. It must be a great thrill to come home from Radnor with any ribbon, let alone the blue one.
Well, exactly. You know, it makes me always very excited because it's an accumulation of all the homework I did with that horse all year to come together as a team, as one, to do well at Radnor. And that's what you're seeing here. Whether you finish with a Concours Complet or you won it, you have to be excited. You know, and the other riders that didn't do so well, they'll go home to the drawing board. And the riders that did well, well, they'll have a high all year.
Well, here's the rider with the high all year. There's Abigail Lufkin and Lighter Than Air. Well, this is Brian O'Connor, along with Ralph Hill, thanking you for being with us. And we'll see you down the road for future coverage of 3-day eventing.